part of my life for so long.
Oh my god. I'm writing an essay tonight. It's like practicing.
So if, for example, you don't know who Luke Skywalker's dad is,
what?
And if you'd rather watch the movie first to find out, now's the time to leave. I've had, in the however many times I've done this presentation, I've had many people, I think it's more and more as the films get older and older, many people who have never seen any Star Wars film. And that begs the question, if you've never seen any Star Wars film, what order do you watch it in? Do you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6?
No.
4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3. 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Because that's the way we all watch them, right? Because really the first time through it's about Luke, but the second time through it's about Anakin. It's kind of interesting how that works out. It prevents the whiplash that occurs going from 3 to 4 as far as special effects and everything else. We're going to be talking about the music of these great films, and the guy responsible for that, of course, is John Williams. Back when he first wrote the original Star Wars, he was a relatively unknown film composer. Now he's essentially the king of all of them. And when you're talking about writing music for film, and writing music by itself is a difficult thing to do. Writing great music, of course, is that much more challenging. Writing music for film has a lot of interesting challenges that we as consumers don't really think about very often. For example, have you ever noticed that when the soundtrack is accompanying the drama in the film, things line up, right? They're about to kiss, and bam, and then you get this downbeat, that kind of thing. That doesn't just happen magically. It's something that it takes a tremendous amount of effort and calculation. The film composer will get the rough draft version of the film and go through and actually write down, when certain things happen. Okay, the door slams here, and the car takes off here, or whatever. And then they'll write the film music to match that. So like the tempo sometimes will change every measure very subtly, so it can be right on track when, a certain event happens. So to make any music line up that way is difficult. To make great music line up that way, music that when you're listening to it, you don't pay attention to the fact that it just happens to line up. That's amazing. So it's a tremendous amount of work. And I think that's one of the reasons why John Williams is so revered in the music community. So what we're going to do, speaking of great pieces of music, we're first going to look at a few pieces that are just, they just occur maybe once in the films and don't happen again, but they're still really cool pieces of music. So for example, in episode 1, Because he portrayed a lot of that through the music. And the technique that he used here is not a new one. It's called leitmotif, and it was used by another famous composer, Richard Wagner. What that is, it's the use of a particular theme that portrays or represents a person or a concept or a place, something like that, where that theme represents it. Wagner used it in his operas, namely his Ring cycle of operas, which was a huge epic. It was like three or four nights of straight storyline, and it would have these little bits of music that would represent maybe a particular character or a device in the plot, you know, like an object or something like that. when John Williams was first asked to write the music for the first Star Wars film, I'm sure that George Lucas told him that this was going to be, you know, this was a story out of a larger epic. And, you know, even before they knew if they were going to have the funding to make more than one film, I think that was, you know, one of George Lucas's selling points to John Williams, and one of the things he asked him to think about as he wrote the music. And so, in the same way that Wagner did in his operas, he actually used this leitmotif concept. I don't think it was a coincidence. He was probably thinking, oh, this is going to be kind of like, you know, Wagner and the Ring cycle and that kind of thing. And so that's where that comes from. So what we're going to do this afternoon, is I'm going to play some themes. And your job is to see if you can figure out what or who or where they represent. I'll tell you the answers, but I'll let you think about it for a minute and see if you can spot them. Some of them will be easy, some of them will be not so easy. I don't know. Of course, if you've seen this six times already, then you probably know all of them. Here's the first one.